talking about Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and who else that we talked about last week?
Hamza.
Sayyidina Hamza radiallahu anhu. So outside and inside, they're not achieving anything. So today we will look at the reaction of the people of Quraysh towards these two things. For sure, it's we wanna get rid of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So 4 points that I will try my best to cover today in these few minutes, inshallah ta'ala. The trial of killing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the beginning. This is not the night when he migrated from Mecca to Medina yet, but they plotted against him and they tried to get rid of him. Number two, the out of being so stressed and oppressed, the Prophet ﷺ is making dua against the people of Quraysh, and we'll know what they themselves did. Yani with the Prophet ﷺ, when he made the dua, what happened to them? And number three, the death of Abu Talib. And number four, the death of Khadijah radiallahu anha. So the first point is, now the people of Quraysh, you know what, they got together. Khalas, we cannot stop the migration to Abyssinia. We cannot stop people from accepting Islam inside Mecca. So let's get rid of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is mentioned in an authentic hadith reported on the authority of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. He said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that tomorrow we will be in a place called Haith Bani Kinan. It's a place where those people, the people of Quraysh, will get together to plot against the Prophet ﷺ, to plan for killing the Prophet ﷺ. So they said, tomorrow we'll get Muhammad ﷺ and we'll siege the people of Bani Hashim or Bani Abdul Muttalib. We will corner them in a place to force them to hand us Muhammad ﷺ to get rid of him. And this is what came also in an authentic hadith, that they tried to do that. Then Abu Talib, this guy subhanAllah is amazing. And his reaction and his behavior at the time of the Prophet ﷺ gives you a clear indication that you is a chosen person. We don't use this word in Islam. We cannot say that we are a chosen like other people, but we are the best ummah. We are. As individuals, there is a doubt about it now. But as ummah, we are. But look at this guy. This guy, he was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he took the responsibility of protecting him. No matter what happens, nobody can touch Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the people of Quraysh, they get together and they try to do that. He collected Bani Abdul Muttalib, all of his nephews and brothers, and he collected all of them and told them, you know what, here is Muhammad. And those people want to get him, and we have to protect him. كما تقول الرواية, as came in the authentic hadith, that all of them, mu'min or kafir, they tried their best to protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they went to a place called the Valley of Abu Talib, or as we say in Arabic, Shi'b Abi Talib. Place, they cornered or sieged them in that place. Imagine the people of Quraysh, khalas, they got so annoyed because Abu Talib took the decision. Here is what we will do. Get together, they got together, they wrote that sahifa, that page, that agreement, that لا يبيعونهم ولا يبتعون منهم. They don't sell to, imagine that we do this with a little country in our area. If you do this, how will be the effect? It will be a great effect. So لا نبيعهم ولا يبتعون منهم. So the people of Quraysh is saying clearly, like, those Banu Abdul Muttalib, we don't sell anything to them, they don't buy anything from us. ولا ننكحهم ولا ينكحوا منا. We don't marry from them, we don't marry their ladies or girls, and we don't allow them to marry any girl from our side. ولا, يعني, there is no any type of dealing with them. For how many years? 1 year?
Three.
Google? Are you Googling it? No, it's 3 years. For 3 years, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are many stories that happened actually during that time when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with his companion in the and his family. A lot of them were non-Muslim, by the way, but they protected him, Hamiyya, as we say in Arabic, Hamiyya, because he is one of their family. That's it, a member of their family. That's it. Yani, they were good people in a way, good people. For 3 years, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, كما جاء في الواسح أنهكه الجهد أو الجهد وأنهك من كان معه. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got so tired and sick, along with all of the people who were with him, but the main focus and concern for all of those people was the protection of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time. 3 years, then some of Quraysh people, they came and they said that you guys are crazy. What you're doing? What we are achieving? People are entering Islam, accepting Islam. We're not achieving anything. Nobody left the Shia and came out. Nobody left that valley and came out to us asking for anything. Actually, what happened is the opposite. People go to him. People start accepting Islam. We're cutting the kinship ties with them. That's all what we do. We're losing anyway. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them the idea to some of Quraysh people to go out and to cut this agreement and break that agreement and let the Muslims, along with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his family members, to go out. Look, sometimes you feel oppressed. He's a Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. ولكن شعر بالظلم والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إياكم أو إياك ودعوة المظلوم حتى إني قرأت من أيام معدودة أن دعوة المظلوم تقبل ولو من كافر. Imagine, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that be aware of the دعاء of the مظلوم. مظلوم, what does it mean? Huh? Yeah, you know it, guys, right? Oppressed, like you wrong somebody, be aware of his dua. Even the Prophet said that the dua of the mazloom, and he said that there is no barrier between the dua of the oppressed or the mazloom and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even that oppressed person is a kafir. And he make dua against you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept his dua. For the Nabi comes out from the shah feeling that, 3 years. They give him the hardest time ever. Ismu shab eh Umar tani. Ismu shab eh Abu Talib. Rekkiz عشان اسألك tani. Shab Abu Talib. Prophet ﷺ come out. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud يروي هذا الحديث ويقول أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما خرج من الشعر قال اللهم سبع أو سبع كسبع يوسف. So imagine that the Prophet ﷺ is making dua against the people of Quraysh that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala afflicts them with 7 years as the 7 years of the people at the time of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. What happened? Do you remember the ayah? Who can say the ayah? What? Surah al-Dukhan. Surah al-Dukhan, I'm saying Yusuf. I'm saying Surah Yusuf, but the ayah, I need the ayah. What did the king see in his dream? Wuli al-Bashir. Aywan. وَقَالَ الْمَلِكُ إِنِّي أَرَى سَبْعَ بَقَرَاتٍ سِمَانٍ يَأْكُلُهُنَّ سَبْعٌ عِجَالٌ. Like seven skinny cows eating seven fat cows. Then when the dream went to Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam, he gave the interpretation as follows. You will have 7 years of good 7 years. You will have good harvest, good product, take care of it. Because after that will be seven ijab, hard years. Seven hard years. These 7 years will eat up everything you guys saved from the first 7 years. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is making dua against the people of Quraysh that they will go through, or they go through the same time that the people, the Egyptian people, went through at the time of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud yaqul, فَجَاعَ الْقَوْمُ وَقَحَطُوا حَتَّى أَنَّهُمْ أَخَذُوا يَأْكُلُونَ الْمَيْتَ وَيَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَيَرَوْنَ الدُّخَانَ مِنَ الْجُوعِ. So the people of Quraysh, immediately after the dua, why did the Prophet ﷺ wait it for 3 years? What do you think? Why didn't he make the dua at the beginning of the 3 years? Who can enlighten us in this way? Why? Why do you think? I didn't read it, but it's a logic. And it's right, inshallah. Why? Exactly. To teach them and to teach you and to teach us that you have to be patient. Nothing comes easy. Yani you don't come, and you know why? Why don't you take the 4 years in 1 year and finish your degree in 3 months? Because you have to go through that. You have to learn. You have to learn patience. And the Prophet ﷺ was teaching his Sahaba, you have to be patient, nothing easy. So at the end, he made the dua وسلم, until the people of Quraysh had to eat the dead animals. والجلود, and the skin of the animals, they ate it. No rain at that time. Look what happened. فجاءه أبو سفيان. Abu Sufyan was a very intelligent man. He was a leader of Quraysh at a certain point. Very intelligent. He knows who a tajir in any situation, he wanna be a winner. He doesn't lose. He doesn't wanna lose. So he went, فجاءه أبو سفيان وقال يا محمد ألا تدعي أنك نبي وأنك جئت بالرحمة فادع ربك لنا. Imagine he's kafir, Abu Sufyan, at that time, and he is telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, oh Muhammad, you claim that you are a prophet. He's not a prophet for him yet. You are a prophet, and you came with mercy, right or wrong, right? So why don't you call and make a dua for your Lord to make that easy on us? طيب, if you are in the position of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, what are you going to do? Walla ya ammi guys, what for that? I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to make dua for you. How come? How come I make dua for you and you just, again, Nabiul Rahman صلى الله عليه وسلم, he came for mercy. يعني maybe Abu Sufyan used the right way to get the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, but still you and I will be different in reaction. But again, that's why, ikhwanna, I'm insisting and insisting and insisting. However, sometimes I see the masjid empty on Friday, but I feel so happy when everybody's here as tonight because of this. We learn from actions, from the actions of the Prophet ﷺ. Keep saying hadith and ayat and everything that doesn't click as the actions click. Prophet ﷺ, just for 3 years he has been torturing. He goes through hard time, or went through hard time, right away after that big dua, Allah accepted his dua, he didn't leave them for the 7 years. If he didn't make the dua for them, it will be khalas, the dua of the Prophet is acceptable. فيقول سيدنا عبد الله بن مسعود فدعا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ربه فسقوا الغيث. ركز معي في العرب. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم دعا, made a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala right away that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for them. فَسُقُوا الْغَيْثِ. Al-Hadith came with the fa. And when in Arabic, when you use the fa, means that it was right away. Right away, the rain came down on them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for them because of the dua of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Amr al-Thalith, as I told you, I'm going to be talking about four things. Right after the Prophet ﷺ and his companions and his family member came out from Shaykh Abu Talib, Abu Talib got so sick. And that's why I'm saying this guy is so interesting. So interesting. When you read about him, subhanAllah, you're lucky and I'm lucky. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cause us all to die as Muslims. Because it's enough for you that you're born as Muslim. We were reading that hadith yesterday about just you are born as Muslim, it's a great ni'mah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose you to be a Muslim. Number one. Fa Abu Talib got so sick. He's lying down on his deathbed. the main protection for the Prophet. That's why some scholars, they call that year the year of sorrow. Aam al-Huzn, the year of sadness. Because now, two main people that the Prophet gets the support, the physical support from Abu Talib and the spiritual support. وفي حد بيتكلم في التليفون يا حبيبي؟ طب خلاص نسمعه. طيب قول له، قول له يا اخي يعني قول له ما انا لو اعرف اطلع بره هطلع بره والله. I don't want to bother him if I can give the khutbah from outside, I will do it. Anyway, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now is getting the main support from those two people. Abu Talib, who is kafir. By the way, some people, they don't like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that. When we say that Abu Talib died as kafir, some people, they don't like it. How come you say about the uncle of the Prophet that he was kafir? I did the same thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that, right? He got so sick on his deathbed. وبجواره أبو جهل وعبد الله بن أمية أو أمية بن عبد الله. Okay. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم جاءه وقال يا عم قل لا إله إلا الله كلمة أو كلمة أحاد الله بها لك. Look, الكبر يقتل النفس. If يعني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال جبل من كبر. بالظبط. شوف الشيخ تامر لقط قال لك الشيخ خرب. مثقال ذرة من كبر. He's not allowed to Jannah the one who has an atom or the weight of atom of kibr of arrogance in his heart. Little thing of arrogance. That's why Prophet ﷺ came to visit Abu Talib on his deathbed and he said, my dear uncle, say la ilaha illallah kalima. You know, in East India, we say the kalima, right? Say the kalima, la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. A word with which I can intercede for you with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you guys remember, Prophet ﷺ, and I mentioned that hadith before, there was a little boy helping and supporting serving the Prophet ﷺ, a Jewish boy. Who remember the riwayah? This boy was a Jewish. And the Prophet ﷺ heard that he was dying. He was in deathbed. Then the Prophet ﷺ went to visit him. He said to him, say la ilaha illallah. Then the boy looked at his dad. Look exactly like Abu Talib. فَقَالَ لَهُ أَبُوهُ أَطِعْ أَبَوْ قَاسِمْ. His dad told him, listen to Muhammad. He didn't listen to him, by the way. Like you saying to your son, pray. And memorize Surah Al-Humaza. And you don't memorize it. Okay? Sometimes it happens. You bring your son, some people, they bring their kids in the weekend to school and they went outside. Sunday, sometimes if we're late before the prayer, I come and some people they pick up their kids and they leave. Yahi, what are you doing? This Jewish man tells his son, Atta Abu Qasim, listen to the Prophet. Then he said it, this boy, one word, he said it, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Then look what the Prophet said about him. Alhamdulillah, alladhi anqadhahu bi min an-nar. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who said to him, this little boy, throw me from the hellfire. But with Abu Talib, it didn't work. The Prophet is telling him, say la ilaha illallah, wa bi jawarihi Abu Jahl and Abdullah ibn Umayyah, both of them, they're telling him, ya Abu Talib, bal millata Abdul Muttalib, ya Abu Talib. They're telling him, you know what? No, don't listen to him. فتقول, as came in the authentic narration, the last word that Abu Talib said, millata Abdul Muttalib. It's the religion of Abdul Muttalib, which was not one of the, the authentic, it was not Islam. He was not a follower of Isa alayhi salam. He was not Muslim. He was not on Al-Fatra. He was idol worship. Absolutely. بل ملة عبد المطلب فمات عليه. فأنزل الله تبارك وتعالى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول أستغفرت لك لولا أني I hope that I can make istighfar for you, however, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids me from doing that. وما كان استغفار إبراهيم لأبيه إلا عن موعدة وعدها إياه. يعني it's not يعني استغفار سيدنا إبراهيم, he did it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that. حتى even يا أخي there are rules. ما هو إحنا we live in a non-Muslim with a non-Muslim community, and sometimes you have a boy, his like grandfather is a non-Muslim. You make dua as much as you can when they're alive that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala get them to Islam, but once they die, ولا تصلي على أحد منهم مات أبدا ولا تقم على قبره. Don't make dua for them anymore. لذلك الله تبارك وتعالى يقول about Abu Talib. That's why we say he died as kafir. لأن الله تبارك وتعالى قال إنك لا تهدي من أحببت ولكن الله يهدي من يشاء. يعني you don't give guidance to whomsoever you love. Do you think that the Prophet ﷺ didn't used to love Abu Talib? He used to love him the most. The guy is giving him the main support. But he's going to do it. Khalas, died as a kafir. He did his best with him. He gave him the message. He gave him the reminder. Day and night, khalas, he did his part. But, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave guidance to whomsoever he wants. But, the ulama had two authentic hadith about this, amazing actually, that Abu Talib, you might think about it, that this guy did, he helped Islam somehow, right or wrong? Did he help Islam or not? He helped the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, أنه كان في أعلى النار أو في أسفل النار فشفع له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فنقل إلى أعلى النار. He's in the hellfire, هو خالدين فيها ما دامت السماوات والأرض. If somebody dies as a kafir, and you and I cannot say that he's a kafir, by the way, up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't just sit and you know what, oh yeah, I have three friends at work, this is kafir, this is fatiq, this is what some of you classify people that. No, you can't do that. At school, you cannot do that. It's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But anybody dies in kufr, they eternally in the hellfire. However, came in the authentic hadith that أقل أهل النار عذابا أبو طالب. The less of the people of the hellfire in punishment, Abu Talib. Do you want to know his punishment? Ayun? Yes. أنه والعياذ بالله الله سبحانه وتعالى يلبسه عليه من نار يغلي منهما دماغه. نسأل الله عز وجل أن يعافينا جميعا من عذاب النار وأن يدخلنا الجنة بسلام. That this guy, Abu Talib, he is the less in the hellfire of punishment. He has two shoes with the hellfire, and from which his brain is boiling all the time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the hellfire. Number four, Khadijah radiallahu anha. You want to listen about how Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha used to think about Khadijah? تقول radiallahu anha ما غيرت من امرأة قط. She said,
I never felt jealous at any woman except Khadija. وَإِنِّي لَمْ أَرَهَا. She never seen her. She never seen Khadija. وَلَكِنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَانَ يَذْكُرُ خَدِيجَ فَيَقُولُ لَهُ أَلَيْسَ مِنْ امْرَأَةٍ غَيْرُهَا فَيَقُولُ هِيَ كَانَتْ وَلِي مِنْهَا الْوَلَدْ وكان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يذبح الشاة فيبعث منها لأصدقاء خديجة رضي الله عنها. So imagine that Khadija, she also died at that year. Few days after the death of Abu Talib, the death of Khadija رضي الله عنها. And Sayyidina Aisha is telling us about how much the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to love Khadija on a personal level as a husband and wife. Forget about the support now. He used to love her the most. رضي الله عنها وصلى الله عليه وسلم. She said that he used to be so jealous at Khadija. He used to mention her all the time. And when I say no woman on earth except Khadija, then the Prophet starts saying and counting the merits of Khadija. She used to be. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me kids from Khadija. Prophet used to sometimes when he slaughtered a sheep out of being dutiful to Khadija, he used to send from that meat to the friends of Khadija out of being يعني, dutiful to Khadija. Sayyidina Jibreel, and let me conclude with this hadith, two hadith. Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam, جاء إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم فقال يا محمد هذه خديجة آتية بإناء من طعام أو شراب بطعام أو شراب فأقرئها من الله السلام ومني السلام وقل لها وأخبرها بأن الله يعدها ببيت في الجنة ليس فيه أو بقصر في الجنة ليس فيه وصب ولا نصب. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is sitting, and Jibreel alayhi salam come down to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, telling him, you know what, Khadijah is coming right now with some food or drink, so say salam to her from me, from Jibreel alayhi salam, and from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and tell her that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing for her, for Khadijah, a place in Jannah, palace, that has no hard times. As a reward for her, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul, khayru aw nisa' al-Jannah, right? Yeah. Khadijah bint Khuwaylid wa Fatima bint Muhammad wa Asiya bint Limba'a. Ma hiya zawjat Fir'aun, bas hiya abuha is Khuwaylid. Eh? Aywa? Who said? Min la yal? Fi wahad ala, Abdullah, right? Muzahim, right? Tawlt Muzahim? Tayyib, barakallahu fi. Wa Asiya bint Muzahim, zawjat Fir'aun. واحد مرة كان بقول لك إيه الفرعون عليه خلاص هي عليه لعنة الله بس هو أنا عليه حاجة تانية خالص كان يماجن يعني بس أدون سيد يعني وآخرهم ومريم ابنة عمران. So the best of women ever, خديجة number one رضي الله عنها, فاطمة the daughter of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, number three آسيا the wife of فرعون, the daughter of Muzahim, and Maryam, the mother of Isa alayhi salam, and the daughter of Imran. Those are the best of women ever. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam have no support in Medina, in Mecca. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his friends and his companions and his Muslim fellows, they have hard time in Mecca. Let's go outside and see, maybe other people will feel for us. Some people will يعني, give us support. Then the Prophet ﷺ think about a place close to Mecca, not that far, not in Medina yet, not Medina yet. It's a place close to Mecca where the Prophet ﷺ went. What happened with the Prophet ﷺ when he went? How did those people receive the Prophet ﷺ? How was it with the Prophet ﷺ when he tried to go outside Mecca for the first time? Inshallah ta'ala, that will be the topic for not next week. Not next Friday, because I'm going to be out of town, inshallah ta'ala. The week after, inshallah ta'ala, we will talk about the first trip, or da'wah trip, that the Prophet ﷺ take outside the boundaries of Mecca, and to where we will mention that, and what happened, inshallah ta'ala. Bismillah azza wa jalla al-mu'allimana, ma'am fa'ana wa ma'am fa'ana wa ma'allimana, fa huwa liyudharika al-qadr alayhi. Jazakumullah khayr wa sallamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.